I've been telling you for the last 2 weeks that you are only as strong as your what? Source. Please put that in your notes. You are only as strong as your source. I don't care how good of a phone you got, iPhone 15, Nokia 1. Eventually, that battery gonna run out. Now, here's what's crazy. We got all these new iPhones. Your iPhone is a computer, a laptop, an assistant, an encyclopedia, a phone, a fax machine, email. Back in the day, all I had was a blue Nokia. The screen wasn't even in color. We had one game on Nokia called what? Snake. Look at the young folk like, Snake? What's Snake? We had one game called Snake, and if I'm lying, y'all stop me. I would charge my Nokia on Monday. It didn't die till 2 Mondays from then. Who am I preaching to? Now I charge my iPhone at 1 o'clock. It's dead by 1:45. And I have to do replugging in. That phone will only be as powerful as its source. And what I'm trying to get you to realize is if clout is your source, if affirmation from your friends is your source, if bragging about how much money you got is your source, is your title or your reputation your source, it's gonna run her out. It's gonna run out. But my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. That's why we sing songs like, "You are the source of my strength. You are the strength of my life." We will be strong. Somebody say strong. That's our word for the year. That is our mantra. That's our calling card. 2024, we are strong. If you look at the logo of strong, strong has three bars atop of the O. Those three bars, the first bar represents what? Inspiration. Second bar is revelation. Third bar, transformation. All right. All right, class. Here's the open book test. I want you to answer this for me. Inspiration is what? Move me. Please put that in your notes if you don't have it. Inspiration means to move me. When I say our word for Rock City is strong, when I say our word for Rock City is strong, what I'm saying is my goal as your pastor, as the leader of this church, is for our church to inspire you. I'm trying to move you. I want people excited to come to church. Now, don't put me on the spot, but I want to ask this question. Who really be at work like, "I can't wait till Sunday"? Look at God right there. Who woke up this morning like, "Go on, get up now. I'm trying to get to church." Okay? Overflow, ask this. Who was moving slow in your house that you want to hit now because you didn't get your seat? Like, "I told you we should have got up 30 minutes ago. You taking your time. This ain't like your grandmama church. You can't guarantee a seat." Because it inspires me. Somebody say it inspires me. It moves me. Push. It moves me. It makes me want to be better. It makes me want to get back involved in church. It makes me want to clap my hands. You want to know why I like Rock City Church? Because most of y'all in here introverted and don't even like people, don't even like being put on the spot. You don't even like moving. You ain't even a shouter, but you be at because it what? It moves you. So as so goes your church, so go you. So what I'm saying is I want to move you so therefore you can leave here and move somebody. I'm preaching if you receive it. Your circle can't stay the way they are as long as you in the circle. I don't know what y'all did before y'all let me in, but you ain't going to do it now that I'm in. Or you can just kick me out and everybody who want to go to another level can come with me. Because if you stay around me long enough, I'm going to move. I'm preaching to somebody. I'm gonna move you. So inspiration is move me. I'm trying to move you to get you inspired and motivated so you can go to God and get a revelation. And revelation is what? See me. I want you to be able to see you the way God sees you. All the preaching I do won't amount to nothing if you get home and can't see you. Am I preaching to anybody? I want you to see you. I want you to know you are fearfully and wonderfully made, that God has a plan for your life, that you are not a reflection of your bank account. You are not a reflection of your social status. You are not what a negative mama, you are not what a messy mama and an absent daddy called you. You are not the sum total of your last three relationships. You are what God said you are. Even if you're on the bottom, I want you to see yourself as the head and not the tail. Even if you ain't got a dime in the bank, you ought to see yourself as the lender and not the borrower. Put a little weight on you, see yourself slim and say, "I am cute." In Jesus' name, am I preaching to anybody? I want you to see you. And when you see you, you're going to walk different. When you see you, you're going to believe different. When you see you, you're going to know, man, God got something special with my name on it. Inspiration, move you. Revelation, see you. Transformation, change you. Why? Because it's something, put this in your notes, I'm going to say it until God calls me home. There is something that the church has neglected called participatory deliverance. Participatory deliverance. What is participatory deliverance? This is when God requires something from you in order for you to come out. You know that woman in the Bible who had been bent over and sick for 18 years. Jesus sees her in church, and the scripture says he told her to come here. Why would he make a sister who could barely walk, walk? Because he was trying to prove a point that there will be seasons when I come to you, but then there will also be seasons where you got to do something. God is not this genie in a bottle that you can come to church, put $10 in a bucket, scream loud enough, and go home and everything be fixed. Even if God pulled you out. See, this is why we need good teaching, because we got to conflate good teaching with grandmama theology. Grandmama said if he got to reach way down, what will he do, church? He'll pick you up. You want to know what my problem is? God has reached way down. He has picked you up. You keep laying back down. God's not going to fix your credit from heaven. God ain't going to fix your family from heaven. God's going to inspire you, hope you get a revelation to see who you are, and then empower you to make something happen for you. Now, everybody ain't going to shout, because some of y'all like playing victim. But six of us have matured to a place this year where, God, you ain't got to do it for me. If you give me the strength, I kick the door open and get it myself. So hear me when I say this: inspiration, revelation, transformation. I told you I want you to be strong in the Lord. That's so important to me. I want you to be strong in the Lord. All my teenagers, I want to hear you saying that I'm going to be strong in the Lord. When you're facing peer pressure, this ain't an adult message. This word is for everybody. When you at school and you're dealing with peer pressure, I will be strong in the Lord. When you at work and you're dealing with peer pressure, I will be strong in the Lord. When insecurity is trying to take over your mind, I will be strong in the Lord. I told you that there are five ways the enemy attacks our faith. Who remembers that, okay? Okay, five ways the enemy attacks our faith. Can you put this on your phone? Take really good notes. If it's your first time, I got issues. So if I say take notes, just put your head down like you taking notes to make me feel good about myself, okay? All right, so put this in your notes. Just put your, girl, put your head down. There you go, right there. There you go, right there. You go. Just messing with you, okay? Here we go, right here. Ready? Right. Put this in your notes. Five ways or five areas that the enemy attacks your faith. We're going to use an acronym for faith. Here it is, F-A-I-T-H, fear, anger, immaturity, tiredness, hurt. Michael, fear, anger, immaturity, tiredness, hurt. This was real good. 2 weeks ago, we talked about what? Fear. And some of y'all left out of here on another level, because I love Rock City Church. We don't fake it. We keep it all the way real. If I'm being honest, there are some things in my life that causes fear. Every time I get ready to step out on faith, I start hearing that negative voice in my spirit telling me everything that's going wrong, what's not going to be right, getting ready to run for office, getting ready to do certain things. Fear will get in your mind. Am I going to raise enough money? Who going to have my back? Can I count on the people I've looked out for? Stepping out on faith is scary. Yeah. Have you ever stopped to consider that doing wrong is easy? Who else been tripping on that lately? Think about it. When you want to do wrong, it ain't even scary. No, I want to just go eat. I want to go eat. I can get crab legs, potatoes, pizza, nachos, whatever I want. Fast. Ooh, Jesus Christ. Ooh, Lord. See, because stepping out on faith requires you to lean on something other than you. And some of us have been dealing with fear, but you left here 2 weeks ago on another level. Because you learn how to pray. This time when fear hits you, you said, right now in the name of Jesus. I'm going to see if you know the scripture. According to 2 Timothy 1 and 7, for God has not given me the spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. See, you ain't get excited right there. For God, Michael, has not given me the spirit of fear. That lets me know that fear is a what? Fear is a spirit. If this is your first week, don't miss that. Fear is a spirit. And the scripture says, because it's a spirit, God did not give it to me. So if God didn't give me fear, I then have to do an investigation and see where did it come from. Because all your fear didn't come from the devil. Some of your fear came from people who believe in you. They just ain't got enough faith to believe it for themselves. So in their good intention of warning you, they deposited fear. For God has not given you the spirit of fear, put church on it, but of power, but of love and a sound mind. I want to speak over your life. Fear ain't going to hold you back this year. Ooh, Pastor Mike, who been praying about starting a business? Throw it up in the comments in the room and overflow. Who been praying about going back to school? Who been praying about maybe trying to apply to get a loan for a home and stuff been in your mind? You've been thinking about doing something fresh, doing something new. Who hasn't been dating? And you've been saying, you know what? I think I'm ready to start dating again. But there's a level of fear over you. I got good news for you. For God has not given you, Michael, the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and what? A sound mind. Who remembers the formula for faith over fear? Put this in your notes then. The formula for faith over fear is what if divided by then equals action. I think I'm finna run. I'll be preaching. I'll be blessing me. The formula for faith over fear is what if divided by then equals action. Make that make sense, PMJ. Whenever you get ready to step out on faith, the enemy starts putting what if in your spirit. Well, I'm gonna start the business this year. What if it don't work? Then you divide that what if by then. What if it don't work? Divide it by then God will supply. I'm in the wrong church. Every one of my needs. I'm thinking about going back to school this year. But what if don't nobody help you with your kids and you don't get financial aid? Then God will make a way out of no way. I'm getting ready to believe God for healing, but my body always breaks down. Then God will heal me because he's still Jehovah Rapha. See, there are two types of people sitting on your row. One of y'all will be stuck in a what if. But then three of y'all got enough sense to praise God over a future then. Why, PMJ, here's a word for three of y'all, because I know if he did it for you, he'll do it for me too. See, your neighbor don't even have a clue who they sat next to. They looked you up and down and slept on you that quick. They don't have a clue they sit next to a thin model. Oh my God, I didn't say a thin model. I said a thin model, that I'm proof that if you run out of money, then he'll have somebody pay a bill. I'm proof that if my mother and father forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Your neighbor ain't shouting, so reach over that neighbor, high five another neighbor, and say, give him a then praise. Then, somebody say then. Then we talked about, we didn't talk about it because we got church yet last week, okay? All right, so y'all 1 week behind 9 o'clock. Let me catch you up, all right? So the F is fear. The A is anger. I'm talking about five areas that the enemy uses to attack your faith. The second area is anger. Anger makes a place for the devil. Let's put this in the notes. Put scripture on it. Ephesians 4:26. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Oh, you want to leave right now, but you're stuck inside that pew. And you know if you get up and leave, I'm going to call your name out right there. So here it is. And don't let sin, watch what it says, and don't sin by letting anger what? Control you. Control you. Leave that scripture on the screen. I want them to see this. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. For anger gives a foothold to the devil. That's important. Anger gives a foothold to the devil. If you've ever went rock climbing or climbed one of those walls, you put the harness on. The first thing they tell you to do is grab a spot. Then the second thing they tell you is find somewhere to put your foot. That's called a foothold. It helps you climb. Let's define foothold. Put this in your notes. A foothold is a strong first position. Michael, it is a strong first position. Michael, it is a strong first position. What does that mean? A foothold is a strong first position because I intend on climbing. but I can't climb till I get my foot right. So when you let anger control you, you give the devil a foothold, which means he's under my feet, trying to climb to my heart to make his way to my mind, because he knows my mind controls my body. And he knows the more footholds you give him, the more access he got to your head. Y'all don't like me today. And the Bible says, don't let anger control you. Yep. Who's ever seen a puppet master who has a puppet on a string? Can I ask you a question? How many strings he got on you? Because he know you angry. And that string, some of y'all busy trying to cut soul ties when you need to cut anger ties. Because the devil got a string on your anger connected to your money. And every time something irritates you, you get angry. And he pulled that string. So now you think in order to get over being mad, you got to go buy yourself something. Then you gave yourself a cute name and called it retail therapy. So now anger got a string to your money. Every time you get mad, you go buy yourself something to feel better. Then when your bill due, now you got to pray for something you should have never spent when it was all tied to your anger. Y'all ain't got to like me. I'm cool in the game. Some of y'all don't have no friends, don't nobody want to fool with you, because it's a string to your mouth, to your anger. So every time you get irritated, anger pulls at your mouth. You start popping off, saying whatever you want to say, then got the right to be in your feelings, because don't nobody want to be around you. Why would I come around you after you done said all you said? It's because anger got you messed up. You ain't got to say amen to me. It's cool in the game. You sitting there looking at me mad. I can tell you angry by the way I'm preaching, because your eyebrows doing this and you ain't even trying, because you sitting there in your head like, who does he think he talking to? You? What you gonna do? Because God ain't gonna bless you till you get over you. And maybe God will promote you when he realized your spirit can handle the pressure of the next level. You mad, you angry, you upset, and the devil like, yeah. And God like, if you ever grow, I'll bless you good measure. Y'all don't like me today. A little more up here, Jay, because anger is a spirit. And look what the Message version says. It says, go ahead and be angry. This is the Message version. Go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry, but don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. Don't stay angry. Don't go to bed angry. Don't give the devil that kind of foothold in your life. I'm going to say something, and only six of y'all going to say amen. The rest of y'all going to stay in the witness protection program. But five of us going to get free when I say this right here. You got a right to be angry. You ain't got to say amen to me. After how people treated you, you should be mad. After how folk left you hanging, who you gave your last to, and they treating your last like it wasn't that deep, you should be angry. After you loved them with all you had and they treated you like an option, you should be angry. How you were there for them and yet they won't be there for you, you got a right to be as mad as you want to be. Put scripture on it, Ephesians 4, 26, 27. Go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. Here it is. But don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. Watch this. Don't stay angry. God ain't mad because you mad. He's mad because mad got you. Did you hear what I just said? God's not mad that you mad. He's upset because mad had you. Make that make sense, PMJ? The fruit of anger is sin. How do I know that, Pastor Mike? Because look at what it says in the NLT. And don't sin by letting anger control you, which means your sin was birthed out of your anger. So what does that mean, Pastor Mike? I gotta control my anger, or my anger is going to control me. And I want to say this to you, and I want to read it to you. This is what A. Purdy says. God will never take what you won't willingly give. You have to set anger aside by your own deliberate choosing, with intention and determination, and move ahead with your life. Do I need to read that again? It's a little cold. Watch what I said. God will never take what you won't willingly give. Put that in your notes, please. God will never take what you won't willingly give. You have to set it aside. Okay? I like conflating grandmama theology with practical teaching, okay? Here it is. Lord, if you find anything that's not like you, take it out. You would pray that prayer and you felt so accomplished. You actually thought you were done. Lord, if you find anything that's not like you, take it out. And God told me to tell you, nah, I did that last year. I took it out of you and you went and picked it back up. In 2015, I took that spirit out of you. You went around more people and picked it back up. So this is what we're gonna do in 2023. I'm not taking nothing you won't give up. Because if I take it from you, your immaturity will make you chase it. Which is why you're running after people who don't want you and ignoring people who would love you. Y'all don't like me today. Y'all don't like me today. Which is why you sad, because you can't be friends with folk who don't care about you. And it's loyal people sitting right here like, what about me? It's because we tend to want what don't want us. He says, no, I'm not going to take it from you. Here's what we're going to do. Give it to me. I receive that. I want you to give it to me. I don't think you heard what I just said, because 2023 is going to be a strong year for you, not because you're going to have another zero in your bank account. Not because they're going to propose in March. Not because you're getting ready to walk across the stage and get a degree. Not because you're closing on your house. All that is cool. But what's the use in being in a 7-bedroom mad? What's the use in having $1 million in the bank angry? What's the use of being in cage and all y'all do is fuss? God says, I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in good health. Watch this. Even as your soul. Why would I give you a mansion when you got a shack spirit? Why would I give you $1 million in the bank when you got a broke happiness? God said, I'm not trying to fix what you got. I'm trying to fix who you are. That's critical. That's so critical. So this gonna be the year you're gonna have to give it to him. And that's a different type of prayer. God, I just wanna pray right now. I know I got a nasty attitude. I've been in my prophecy bag. Don't make me start prophesying. So we're gonna have a real moment. Lord, I know I got a nasty attitude. I need you to give me the strength to take that off. Okay. I had an old school mama, who would always say, are your drawers clean? Yes, ma'am. Any holes in them? No, ma'am. Your undershirt clean? Yes, ma'am. Any holes in them? Yeah. What's your socks look? Mama, my socks. Any holes in them? I was like, mama, why? Because something happened to you. Who had one of them mamas? I don't want nobody to have to come. His drawers ain't even clean. He got a hole in his shirt. Okay? All right? But that's how all of us live. You got on a Dolce & Gabbana facade. You got on a Louis Vuitton Gucci facade. And you keep wondering why the devil ain't scared of you. Devil got x-ray vision. You faking fooling them. Hell, like, look at them. They ain't got nothing. They got holes everywhere. Don't even got on matching stuff. They not solid on the inside, which is why you trying to find somebody with some money. Forget the money. I need somebody with some peace, with some joy, with some wisdom, with character, who ain't angry. Y'all don't like me. Watch this. So can I ask you a question? How many footholds have you given the devil? Huh? How many, if he's under your feet and he's trying to make his way to your heart and make his way to your mind, how many footholds has your anger given him? How many steps have you created for him to get on your level? Because fear is a what? Spirit. Fear is a what? Spirit. Which means I have to be able to say, God created me. There it is, a clean heart. And renew a steadfast spirit. Can you put steadfast in your notes? Steadfast. What's the definition of steadfast? Resolute, dutiful, firm, unwavering. Put script, be ye steadfast. I gotta stop, dude. Y'all be making fun of me. And I be preaching to myself. It'd be stuff I don't be realizing I be doing till y'all talk about me. Somebody put on Twitter, when he grunt, it's going down. When he say, Michael, get your notes ready. Be ye steadfast. Unmovable, Michael. Always abounding. Steadfast, unmovable. Which means you gotta say, God, give me a steadfast spirit. Okay, I'm almost scared to say this, okay? Who's ever been grocery shopping? No, not grocery shopping, but grocery shopping with some money. Because it's two types of grocery shopping. It's, I'm going to go ahead and get what I need and get out. Then it's that check hit, and you walk into the, get them cookies right there. No, get the cereal at the top. We're not getting the bottom one this week. Captain Crunch this week. Who know what I'm talking about? I remember my mama when we used to hit around this time of year. Who know what I'm talking about? Overflow, don't laugh at me. Around this time of year, my mama would grocery shop different. Because normally we would get the cereal at the bottom. But she, no, get the one at the top. Like, oh, okay. No, get the cookies you want. Get the Oreo. Like, oh, okay. We walking through there getting all the stuff we want. It's only one problem. We would get home, she said, put the stuff in the refrigerator. All right? The refrigerator would be so packed that she would have to make a decision. Does she stuff it or do she remove something? That's how I'm trying to get your spirit. I'm trying to get you so much peace, so much joy, so much meekness, so much long-suffering, so much temperance that when anger try to get in, peace be like, ain't no room for all that over here. Nah, but what you do? Now take the peace out, put anger on this shelf, put my attitude on this shelf. Now you don't realize that you are insufficient because you stockpile in anger and you low on wisdom. Y'all don't like me. I gotta go. I gotta get you out of here. So I need you to realize that number one, we gotta get over fear. I received that, whoever said it. Number one, we gotta get over what? Fear. Number two, number three, immaturity. We caught up now. Immaturity, okay? Immaturity, 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 immaturity. Yeah. Not just immaturity. I want you to put this in your notes. Spiritual immaturity. See, because you being immature ain't gonna block God, ain't gonna block your faith. Why do you think he said, I want you to have childlike faith? He almost wants you to have a sort of innocence to you. Well, you know, it's like if I tell Miles, eat this. Miles don't even know what it is. He don't know it's nasty till he eat it. He got a childlike faith in his daddy that whatever I say, he's just excited about it. That's kind of how he wants your faith. Trust me. You trust him. Run through that wall. Boom. He wants you to know I'm going to move it. I don't want you so caught up on. See, this is what life do to you. God will be like, run through that wall. And then life have you thinking, but that's going to hurt. Then I'm going to hit it. Then I'm going to pass out. So are you going to move the wall? Are you going to knock down the wall? Are you going to send me through the wall? Now you don't realize 3 years done passed by. You stuck on paralysis by analysis. You so busy assessing it, you ain't bust a move. And God, like, I wish they had childlike faith and just ran. They don't have a clue that wall is an illusion. So it's not just immaturity, because age does not make you mature. Just because you're 60 don't mean you mature. And just because you're 20 don't mean you immature. Spiritual immaturity. Just because one has been a Christian for many years does not mean they are mature. I heard a story about a teacher who had been teaching for 25 years and a promotion became available. And she said, I'm going to apply for the promotion. She eventually didn't get the job. And a teacher who had only been teaching 2 years got the job. She was frustrated and she went to her advisors and said, why didn't I get the job? I have 25 years worth of experience. And her supervisor told her, you only have 1 year of experience 25 times. She says, you've been doing it for 25 years, but there was no growth. So you just repeated the same year 25 times. During that whole time, the teacher never improved. And the question I want to ask you is, are you taking the same test year after year? Are you improving? Are you maturing spiritually where at least this year you got a new devil? Or do every year you fight the same devil with a different face? Chapter one, you walk down the street, you fall into a hole. You say, I never saw the hole. Nobody told me it wasn't a sign. They pick you up out the hole, you go on about your business. Chapter two, you walk down the same street, fall in a hole. You say, I thought by now they would have fixed it. They pick you up out the hole, you go on about your business. Chapter three, you see the hole, fall in the hole. You blaming people still. Now you comfortable in the hole because if they picked you out last time, you know they'll pick you up again. So they pick you up, you going on about your business. Chapter four, you see the hole, you walk around the hole. That's where many of y'all fell in life. You thought it was good enough to just walk around the hole. I'm trying to get you to chapter five. You went down another street. You not strong because you can see it and not go through it. You strong when you make a decision to not even put yourself in that predicament again. And somebody gonna be mad at you this year. You don't call no more. You don't come around no more. You just ghosted me. I ain't ghost you. I picked another street. I grew. Why you keep doing that to yourself? Pastor Mike, we're just gonna go watch a movie. Where? At their house. Where? In their room. Where? On their bed. Where else? Under the cover. Why you do that to you? See, for a season, I said for a season, you're going to have to get to a point where if I got to say this, I'm getting ready to go over here. Let me get my mind right. I might not need to go. Watch this. Watch this. Can you put this in your notes? It's very simple, but I just want you to write it because you may remember it. Stop allowing people to penalize you for growing. You can't penalize me for growing. No. That goes for your relationships. That goes for your marriage. Everybody, friendships. We should be growing together. Well, you used to like so. I don't like that no more. I was 20 and 60 pounds ago. That don't hit like that. No, I can't do that no more. I don't mature. I don't even like that. No, I want to go to bed. I want to just eat and just watch TV. That conversation don't stimulate me no more. I'm growing. Watch this. Put this in your notes. Immaturity represents no growth in an area. Wow. Can I give you scripture? Immaturity represents no growth in the area. Go to Hebrews chapter 5, 11 through 14. Look at what the writer says. There's so much more we would like to say about this, but it's difficult to explain, especially since you are spiritually dull and don't seem to listen. You have been believers for so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone to teach you again the basic things about God's word. You are like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. This is a read, ain't you? For someone who lives on milk is still an infant and doesn't know how to do what is right. Solid food is for those who are mature, who through training have the skill to recognize the difference between right. What the writer is saying is, y'all are preventing me from going deeper. While the material he wanted to share may have been hard to explain, it wasn't so much the difficulty of the material itself as it was their own inability to receive it. He said, there's so much more I want to tell y'all about God, but y'all won't grow. I want to tell you so much more. I'm so tired of just telling you he'll provide. I'm ready to tell you why. I'm tired of saying, you know, God will provide for you. That's milk at this point. You should know that. No, God will provide for you. No, you believe that. Now tell me why. It's because there was a brother by the name of Abraham who God told him to sacrifice his son. He got there and he said, I see the wood, I see the fire, but where's the sacrifice? Out of nowhere, God provided a ram so he didn't have to kill his son. God made a way. So what I'm telling you is when he provides, he will show up. How can I tell you about redacted criticism, social criticism, redactive criticism, social criticism? How can I not talk to you about Christology, pneumatology, the study of numbers, eschatology? We in the end times now. I should be able to, on Sunday morning, do a whole series on the book of Revelation. I should be able to tear that, show you right now why the conflict in Israel is the way it is. Is that the Israel of the Bible or is that a different Israel? What is Palestine and what does Palestine represent? I should be able to sit down with you and say, now I want to show you what we believe. Here's what Muslims believe. Here's what my other brothers believe. Here's what this religion believes. Now let me show you why they're saying that this isn't a Christianity that isn't relevant to you. Let me show you what took place in the 1800s. Let me show you about Martin Luther's thesis or how he stamped that against the wall. Let me show you about the Reformation. But we so busy waiting on a praise break. And what I'm trying to show you is, if this is going to be a strong year for you, we got to get to a point where we mastered the basics. I believe God. I trust God, Michael. I honor God. Now hear me when I say this. This is good. This is good. This is good. Because dull, put this in your notes if you don't mind. Dull, D-U-L-L, I'm finna get you out of here. Dull suggests regression. Dull suggests regression. They're gonna be mad at y'all in Georgia. I'm supposed to be leaving right now. I got a concert in Georgia, but Rock City come first. So they just gonna be mad. I'm gonna figure it out. So if y'all see me running in a minute, we're gonna run. Dull represents regression. This is good. If you buy a knife, it starts out sharp. I wanna stretch your thinking, bro. So either overuse or no use makes it dull. I wanna ask you a question. Have you become dull from overuse or no use? I'ma almost argue most of our faith is dull because you haven't been using it. Y'all don't like me today. When you use it, every move you make so calculated, it don't even require faith. I'm going to do so-and-so because I know I can't afford it. If I move so-and-so, so-and-so around, I'm going to do so-and-so, so-and-so. I'm applying for this job, but my friend who worked there already told me who to talk to, what to say. When do you use faith? For we walk, Michael, by faith and not by sight. So hear me when I say this. You saw how he was frustrated with one church. Look what Paul says right here, Acts 17:10. Look at what it says. That very night, the believers sent Paul and Silas to Berea. When they arrived there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. All the people of Berea were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica, and they listened eagerly to Paul's message. They searched the scriptures all day to see if Paul and Silas were teaching the truth. As a result, many Jews believed, as did many of the prominent Greek women and men. Did you catch that? The people who should have been excited ain't excited. Yet the people who didn't know nothing on fire. So let me free you. Are you dull? Or are you spiritually apathetic? I'm not stopping. I got lots more. Spiritually apathetic. I want you to put this in your notes. Apathy. Apathy. I'm going to give you the definition if it's not already behind me. Apathy. Lack of interest, enthusiasm, or concern. Michael, lack of interest, enthusiasm, or concern. How do I know I'm spiritually apathetic? Do I have a lack of interest, a lack of enthusiasm, or concern? Now I want you to take that definition, apathy, and apply that to most of the areas in your life. In your relationship, do you lack interest, no enthusiasm, and no concern? Do I lack interest to read my Bible? Well, the Bible just ain't interesting to me. Are you excited at least about coming to church? Well, I'd be excited sometimes. Do you actually care or concern when you miss the mark? Y'all don't like me today. And some of us right now, the reason the devil can just come in and out of our lives when he wants to, you're spiritually apathetic. You come to church, log on to church on Sunday. I preach for 45 minutes, let's just say an hour. I stand here and preach to you for an hour. 24 hours a day, 24 hours times 7 days a week is what, 168 hours. So let's write 168 hours at the top of your notes. Under that, put 1 hour. So 1 hour message is supposed to keep you for 167 hours. Your phone can't make it like that. Your car can't make it like that. Your bank account couldn't make it like that. You couldn't live or survive if you never went to sleep and recharged. Yet you got your spirit stressed out. Am I preaching to anybody? So what happens, Pastor Mike, I need you to catch this. The devil wants you to stay apathetic. So let's talk about this. I'm finna send you home. Five signs of being spiritually apathetic. Five signs of being spiritually apathetic. Let me give you all five in case I don't finish. You become familiar, boredom, mediocrity, disconnection, passivity. Michael, familiar. Am I doing okay today? Familiar, boredom, mediocrity, disconnection, passivity. Somebody say familiar. I become spiritually passive, spiritually apathetic, immature when I become too familiar. You becoming too familiar is what's happening in so many instances of our lives. So what does that mean, PMJ? Okay, I know preachers who love preaching at other people's churches because when they preach at somebody else's church, because they've never heard him preach, they get so excited. And when he preaches at his church, they so familiar with him, he feel like it ain't being effective. I know people who actually woke up this morning, put on clothes, got in a car, not even knowing if a drunk driver was next to them, made it to their destination and never told God thank you because they're so familiar with his protection. I can come down your row if you want me to. I know somebody who went to work last week like they couldn't get fired. You so familiar with God's grace that you actually go into a man-made job in a horrible economy thinking can't nothing happen to you because you actually did your job. I had the comfort of family today who the husband lost his job. He didn't do nothing wrong. The company cut everything by 30%. So what you don't realize is for some of you, the worst thing that has happened to you is God's been good. I'm going to say that again. For some of you, the worst thing that could have ever happened to you was the fact that God's been good. Michael, God's been good to you so long that you have now become so familiar that you actually think he's supposed to bless you. He's supposed to cover you. He's supposed to keep you. You woke up this morning when somebody didn't wake up and you were so familiar with him that instead of you getting to your knees and saying thank you, you jumped up and said thank you, Jesus, and kept it moving. Had it not been for the grace of God. Y'all don't like me today, but it's cool in the game. I done got so familiar. I'm too familiar with God. Too familiar with God that I can actually pray to God for a blessing. He give me a job and I don't even tithe, then be in my feelings when he don't come through. I'm so familiar that I can just move through life thinking he's supposed to do what he's supposed to do for me. I'm working on a new single right now, right? So we've been in the studio fixing it, recording it. They've been mixing it. I sent it to my partner, Slate, and Slate sent me 10 errors in it in 20 minutes. I said, yo, why you hating this? I'm not hating. I said, I listened to this song 100 times. Ain't nothing wrong with the song. He gave me something that'll bless you. He said, you got demo ear. I said, what's demo ear? He said, you've heard it so much, you become accustomed to the imperfections that now you can't hear them. And it made me think about you. Some of y'all got demo God. That he's been so good to you, moving at such a rapid pace for you, that now you actually think you're entitled to his blessings. You actually walking around now like you did it. Your neighbor don't like me, so just reach over that hater and high five another neighbor and say, Grandmama taught me everything that happened, Michael. To me, that was good. God did it. Your neighbor ain't shouting because they too familiar. But I need three of y'all to say, I ain't that familiar with God. If he woke you up this morning, clothed you in your right mind, gave you the activities of your limbs, let everything. I gotta go. Familiar, somebody say familiar. This is the longest we've been in church. Put this in your notes. Put this in your notes. I'm giving you homework. I want to improve my prayer life, Pastor Mike. Here's your homework for the next 7 days. I want you to go home today, make a list of all the things in your life you are grateful for, and for 7 days out loud, thank him for it. I've been too familiar. I feel God on that one. I've been too familiar. See, grandmama and them didn't have deep prayers. That's why some of y'all can't pray. You waiting to pray for big stuff. Grandmama and them prayed for little stuff. Here it is, you got a doctorate degree, 2 master's degrees, and you smarter than your grandmama and them, yet you can only pray for 30 seconds. Granddad, dear right now, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for waking me up, dear Heavenly Father, that my cooling board wasn't my headboard. Oh, thank you, Lord, that you put food on my table, and you put clothes on my back, and oh, yeah. I just want to thank you. You kept my family, Lord. You kept my mind, Lord. Oh, now we got to write long songs. They didn't even have choir rehearsal. Somebody on the third row would just shout, if I couldn't say a word, I'd just wave my hand. Ooh. Now you sitting in here with LED lights, Grammy Award winning singers, and won't even lift your hands because you're too familiar. You better not let nobody convince you you arrogant. Some of y'all gonna have to leave church and tell a couple people in your group text, hey, I love y'all, but y'all done got a little bit too familiar. I ain't trying to brag. I ain't trying to throw nothing in y'all face. But y'all ain't gonna find too many people like me. I be coming through for y'all. I be holding it down for you. 6 of y'all owe me some money. Ain't even asked for it back. And I noticed your shoes was new last week. I said, I'm gonna let that be what it be. But I wanna be very clear. If y'all keep treating me like I'm regular, I'm gonna walk away from y'all because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I am the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Your neighbor sitting next to you like they ain't sitting next to somebody. Bump them and tell them you're sitting next to a real one. Limo. I gotta get out of here. Treat me like I'm familiar. The devil is a lie. I said the devil is a lie. You got so much favor on your life, they don't even realize half the stuff God doing for them is because they connected to you. 6 of y'all ought to jump up and bust a 360 and shout, this is what favor looks like. This is what grace looks like. This is what overflow looks like. This is what humility looks like. Slap 3 people, high five, and shout, I'm a real one. I'm a monitor. Treat me all familiar. Devil is a lie. What you want to do? That's what you got to tell a couple people. What you want to do? Saved, paid, cute, in shape, a little. I'm blessed. And most people become familiar, but then I'm going to sit down. I'm nowhere near done. Sit down. I'm finishing you home. Just give me 6 minutes because they become familiar. Number 2, I'm finna give them all to you. Boredom. Boredom.
Yeah.
Boredom. 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 Boredom.
John Bloom defines boredom not as the opposite of busyness, but the opposite of interest. You're not bored because you're not busy. You're bored because you're not interested. Pastor Mike, that don't make sense. Okay, cool. How you at work bored? All right, Dre, put the camera on me. Don't put the camera on the crowd because I don't want nobody to see this. Who be at work bored? Two of y'all work for me. Time out. You fired right now on the spot. Okay, so who be at work bored? Throw your hand up. Can I free you? Not because you don't have a reason to be busy, but for some reason what you're doing there just ain't interesting. I want to talk about this. The devil keeps you bored because he knows if you ever get interested in your call, you will go to another level. You want me to tell you why it's easy for you to miss church? Because you got bored with it. You knew it would be two fast songs, one slow song. He gonna scream, he gonna holler. They gonna shout, I go home. There was no attachment. I didn't do nothing at church. I came, I sat down, I went home. Now I can miss two Sundays. It's not that the church ain't busy. It's just I'm not interested. Which is why I'm calling everybody to be a leader. I'm doing something in about 5 weeks called city groups. That's my version of small groups, rock city groups. And what I'm saying is, if you don't get active in your call, this church will never be enough. Now, I'm going to say to you what your last pastor wouldn't say because he was scared he was going to lose you. Okay? It ain't my job to entertain you every week. I want to be very clear. This the best it's going to get. So eventually, if you don't get active and get involved, you know what you're going to say? I just don't feel like I'm growing. You're right. You not. It's like a whole other 1,000 people who are. You not growing. You're right. You're not growing. And you not growing is not indicative of my teaching. You not growing is indicative of your apathy. You ain't got off the sidelines and walked in your call. So that's why I'm telling people right now, I'm going to give in about 6 weeks, we're going to do it. I'm going to take two Saturdays. We're going to come to church. I'm going to train everybody on how to do a small group. And I ain't telling you to do nothing difficult. Bro, I'm saying invite six of your partners over and say, we're going to go hoop. Before y'all hoop, get in a circle, say, hey, I just want to pray with everybody. All right, I want to talk about growing. So here's one of the things I've been dealing with. Growing for me is challenging because sometimes I have to do X, Y, Z. They going to talk back to you. Y'all start hooping. That's it. You're going to come away from that like, hey, man, hey. You know what's going to happen? 3 weeks later, they're going to hit you back. Hey, bro, what you say, it really touched my heart, man. And now the devil in hell like, uh-oh. See, because Pastor Mike can preach, but my message will never match your testimony. I'm preaching if you're receiving. And seven of y'all got a real... So it's easy. Pull your phone out. All you got to do is text city groups to 28950. It's probably a QR code on the screen. I'm trying to get as many people as I can in purpose. I don't want to be no celebrity preacher where thousands of people line up to see me. Then the moment I do something stupid, now y'all gone. No, while I got you, I'm going to try to pour as much of my heart and as much of God's word on you. I'm going to try to get you out of just spectating to participating. I'm going to say this and you hope you receive it. Three of y'all cousins ain't going to die in the streets if you get in your call. My baby brother in church, he followed his brother. Had I been in the streets, he probably would have followed me there. My call called him. My dad's call called me. Am I preaching to anybody? So what am I telling you, brother? Newt, it's going to be on us. It's going to be on us to say, hey, I'm not finna be spiritually mediocre. No, it's time for me to step into my call. So look at this now. What's the third one? Mediocrity. So many people are searching for something that's not even realistic. I want me. You say stuff like, no, I ain't trying to be mediocre. I'm trying to do it big. So it's doing it big. And when did you equate an ordinary life to a mediocre life? You mean I can have a good job, pay my bills, go home to my family, my kids honor me, I'm in purpose, and that's mediocre to you because I ain't getting flued out. Which one you want? You want the party of purpose? You want your life to be so exciting that in 20 years, all you got is memories. Mediocrity. I'm gonna stop because y'all don't like me. Being spiritually mediocre, play soft. I saw two people roll their eyes at me.
You was good 3 minutes. Wait.
What is being spiritually mediocre? Somebody in the comments, somebody in Overflow, somebody in this room, put this in your notes. Mediocrity is the sum of all the times I chose to take the easy path with my faith. I was being spiritually mediocre. Bro, I can see your spirit turning, right? So it's little things I do. God, I'll be at Wendy's. I love Wendy's. So I'll be at Wendy's, right? And I get to the window and I just hear the Lord just say something like, pray for their kids. Like, I don't even know if it's the Lord sometimes. It's like, I know God put a prophetic gift in me. So to me, to keep it sharp, sometimes I just say what I feel. I'm not always accurate, not always right. I just say what I feel. I go up to the window, hey, you have kids? Yes. Lord told me to pray for them. Oh, my God. Oh, and I just pray. And I pull up, I'd be like, woo. One time I went to one, I said, you have a son, right? She's like, no. Nephew, no. Is there any young man? No. What do you want, sir? I was like, all right, God bless you. Yeah. I was wrong today. Hey, I can be 86%. There's still a V, right? But to me, y'all gonna laugh. I'd be feeling like God be like, hey, just trust. Hey, you are spiritually mediocre when you do just enough. And there's no conviction to be all God called you. Did you pray today? Yeah, I prayed. See, you're spiritually mediocre when you do enough to satisfy you. He said, pray, I prayed. Did you pray like he told you to pray? Somebody watching me right now from all over the world and in this room, God's been telling you lately to start praying with your team, with your circle. Hey, y'all, I just want to pray. And then you try to start, hey, we need to pray. All right, man. And you never. And then you quit because you were afraid of how they would see you. When you don't realize God was calling you to be more than what they see. That's good. Number four, disconnection. I'm going fast as I can. Disconnection. Here's the problem. We live in a digital age now. So it's an illusion. You can have 500 friends on Facebook and still feel alone. Watch this. Put this in your notes. Solitude is a gift from God. Isolation is not. Solitude is from God. Isolation is a tool of the enemy. Isolation is when you've been locked up. Solitude is when you've been locked in. Isolation is when the lock is on the outside. Solitude is when the lock is on the inside. Did you catch that? I go into solitude when I'm trying to keep them out. You go into isolation when they're trying to keep you. And the devil tricks you into going into isolation. I'm the only one dealing with this. Who's ever felt like what you're going through nobody would understand? Anybody? Who's ever been at home and a storm broke loose and your power went out? Throw your hand up. What you do first? You hit a couple switches, right? Then what you do? Look out the window. And you try to see if somebody else power out, right? I think they power out all over the neighborhood. Then you go outside, right? You go outside, then everybody outside. Hey, y'all power out over there? Oh, okay. Crazy, ain't it? Y'all be good over there, huh? Then you go back in the house and you cool. Because you know it ain't just me with the problem. It ain't just me with the problem. We all got it. See, I'm trying to make you like my neighbor. He got a generator. So when the power go out in our neighborhood, we all go outside. Y'all good over there? Y'all good over there? He be standing on his front porch swagging. Y'all all right? If y'all need to come over and put something in the refrigerator, let us know. And I'd be like, no, I'm good. You know what I do? I go in my room and just look like, why is he got that generator? Can I ask you a question? The money gonna go out for everybody in your family? Which one of y'all gonna have a generator? The whole family gonna be mad. Who gonna have a generator? Let your light shine. Let's go home. Let's go home. Y'all stand up. Number four, disconnection. Number five, passivity. I'm gonna end with this quote right here. Some Christians need encouragement to think before they act. Others need encouragement to act after they think. So what am I saying? Some of you just need to bust a faith move, man. And trust God to be God. Father, I pray right now that I said something that blessed them. That whether they're watching this on a Sunday, a Wednesday, or a Friday, maybe a year from now, this is an on-time word right now for their situation. God, I pray right now that what the devil means for evil, you will continue to work for our good. I ask, God, that you will cover, keep, bless, and protect them. God, some of them are on fire for God right now. And I ask that this stoke that fire. But for those who may not have been on fire, God, right now, like the Bible says, I pray this stirred up the gift that's on the inside of them. I thank you right now, God, that you're doing what eyes have not seen and ears have not heard. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say it. Clap your hands if you love Jesus, man. Even in overflow, clap your hands online. Listen to me, before you leave, you may not know Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus is still the best thing that has ever happened to me. We're not going to put you on the spot. You can text HOME to 28950. We'll have somebody from our team contact you. We'll pray with you. We want you to know that you are in community. I want to say this, and it means the world to me. God did not call us to be alone. Even in the book of Genesis, he said it's not good for man to be alone. I believe we live and we can thrive in community. And so I'm telling you, if you don't mind, text city groups to 28950. We're getting ready to start our small groups. I really want to challenge you to step outside your comfort zone and just lead where you are. It may be 3 people. It may be 7 people. It may be 10 people. It may be you and 2 friends. I really believe God is calling us to be the light that our circle needs. I got a couple guys who all they do is play flag football. One played at, I believe, at Memphis. And he said, Pastor Mike, I'm going to do a 7-on-7. Can I use the field? I said, bro, if that's going to get you and 10 brothers out here to talk about Jesus, that's what I'm talking about. I don't want you to change anything about who you are. Just be who you are, where you are. And I believe it'll be a blessing. So you can text city groups to 28950. Were you blessed today? Amen. I want to thank everybody for praying for my son. My son had knee surgery this past week. Wednesday, it went well. He's at home resting right now. He's going to be down about four to five months. So just thank y'all for praying for my boy, man. I love him so much. Also, I'm asking y'all to just say a prayer for me as soon as church is over. We're jumping on the plane going to, I think, Savannah, Georgia. So if we got any members in Savannah, Georgia, meet us tonight. Myself, the Clark sisters, and Ty Tribbett. It'll be absolutely incredible right there. Y'all said, that sound good right there. That sound good, don't it? So, man, I just love to see y'all. Man, I love you so much. Were you blessed today? My dad snuck in. Show my dad some love right there. Love you, Dad. All right, so listen. If you want to hear more about city groups, if you leave out the sanctuary, if you're in overflow, come upstairs. In the conference room to your right, our team is in there right now. They'll be able to talk with you about it a little more. I really want to challenge. I got big faith. Somebody say big faith. Big faith. I'm believing God for 500 people to take that next step of faith. How crazy would it be? I'm going to show you, if 500 people just reached 5 people, that's what, 2,500 people hearing about Jesus. And what if that kept growing? I want to take an old school model. Jesus took 12 people and changed the world. I believe if we lock in, we can change our world. Somebody say amen. Amen. I love you so much. Do me a favor. Don't forget all my parents. Next Sunday is Pajama Sunday for the children. Next Sunday, hear me, you have to say that at Rock City Church. Hey, it's Pajama Sunday. No, you go back home. It's Pajama Sunday for the kids. So hear me, let your kids wear their favorite pajamas. Try to get to church a little early so they can get logged in. We got a lot of big stuff planned for our babies next Sunday. We want them to be excited about coming to church. So I'm excited about that. God, we want to say thank you.
And we pray a very special prayer. Lord, your will, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. It's in Jesus' name. Everybody say it. Amen. I love y'all so much. We are. God bless y'all. Love y'all so much.
Year of my life, and so it's got to be some challenges. And I don't know about you, but it really was challenging for me, and it blessed me in an amazing way the entire service, especially the word
from start to finish. And even as we're talking about starting, maybe you want to start something new. Right, God is speaking to your heart. Listen, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart, thus saith the Lord. And so listen, you can text home to 28950. That's home to 28950. You can start again. You fell down. We know the righteous man falls seven times, but the key is to get back up. So I think that was a word that got us up. Somebody got away today.
Somebody got away. And it's so true. And you're saying, you know what? I want to make sure I get some seed in the ground.
That's right.
A great word. If you're giving today, you can text iRock in the amount to 28950. This iRock and the amount to 28950. As we always say, when you give the Rock City, you don't give what?
To your church, but you give through your church. And speaking of through this ministry, y'all, something special is happening here. You want to be a part of this movement. Pastor Mike has charged us to create, develop 500 plus live Devo Energy city groups that will take place all over the world. So if you have not already done so, text the word city groups to 28950. From Birmingham to Boston, from Boston to Zimbabwe, we believe that we will be that light that sits on a hill that cannot be dimmed.
Cannot be dimmed. And remember, y'all, tomorrow,
Devo Energy
is going down at 7:21 a.m. Central Standard Time. Make sure you log on Facebook and YouTube, because we're going to talk about this word.
Yep.
And we're going to talk about how we can apply this to our everyday life. Application is so important. So make sure you lock in with us there. What a day.
Listen, continue to keep our pastor covered. He mentioned that he's on his way to Savannah, Georgia.
Savannah, pull up
PMJ,
with your
PMJ, Clark City Sisters, Ty Trippin. Man, that's when he said it, I almost thought about just getting in the car and go ahead and shooting up there. You know what I'm saying?
But listen,
as Pastor James said, we will see you in the morning at 7:21. We may be out of time, but not out of message.
Yes.
Listen, on behalf of Pastor Mike, Lady J, all of us here at Rock Nation, we love you. God bless. Keep rocking. Peace.
See you next time.
gotta do it now. Normally I wouldn't let this break me, so I decided today. Woke up this morning, I'm blessed. Food on my table, I'm blessed. Clothes on my bed, yeah, I'm blessed. I'm blessed, I'm blessed. Devil already know I'm winning. 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 And it's my winning season. I knew you would. Stay cool. Troubles don't last always, so just, yeah.